HarperCollins Children's Books presents When Things Went Wild by Tom Mitchell, read by Gregg Lowe. Chapter 1. Spring and the sun have sprung. Friends play football, families meet in parks, everybody's happy. But not here. The sky's thick with charcoal-drawn clouds, drizzle catches against your cheeks. Welcome to Grand Town, Scotland, the exact middle of nowhere. The nearest cinema's hours away. Nobody in their right mind would choose to live in a place like this. Nobody but my parents. And don't think I'm hating on Scotland. I'm not. I like Scotland. It's this house, my house. A house so old it has a weird name. Aina. An inherited house that belonged to Mum's great-grandmother or someone. A house in the middle of green and brown nothingness. On the day my brother Jack found the device, I was waiting for Wikipedia to load. That's how it started. A slow website. We'd only been here for a week, but already I understood that the days of instantaneous internet were over. Online gaming? Forget about it. Checking Insta? Only if you've a few hours free. It was like falling back in time, but without any of the fun you see in the time travel movies. Dad said we'd end up getting proper fast internet from a satellite someday, but Dad says a lot of things, mostly about policing. The Wikipedia page I waited for was a glossary of Scottish slang and jargon. I was starting at a new school on Monday and didn't want to be caught out by not knowing key terms. Just be yourself, the parents said. But they were so old, they've forgotten that you're only successful in school by doing the exact opposite of this. And I was English, and I was joining two terms in. It wasn't fair. You couldn't get a more perfect situation for encouraging bullying. All that effort I put into making friends back in Nottingham, wasted. It's not easy. You've got to pretend to be interested in other people. It takes work. It takes time. And I'd been popular. Not captain of the sports team popular, but people saying hi to me in corridors popular. What made things worse was that Jack wasn't even starting school until the following September. Dad, when he wasn't off pretending to be a police officer, sorry, a volunteer community support officer, would be homeschooling him. And anyone who's ever done any remote learning knows exactly what that means. Messing around and doing no work. And I love messing around and doing no work. They're my twin passions. Well, them and violent sci-fi films. A knock on my bedroom door. I put on my glasses to see who dared interrupt my me time. Mum, wearing a yellow waterproof jacket and smiling. Good news, she said. We thought we'd go for a walk. No, I replied. No way, I refuse. We're always going for walks. My legs still ache from yesterday. You go, I'm fine. I'm preparing for school. I'm doing research, really. I'm not asking, said Mum. I'm telling. And I opened my mouth to say that I couldn't think of anything worse than going for a walk in the Highlands with Jack again. But no words emerged, because she gave me the look that shriveled my very soul. Get your boots on, she said. Now! Rolling off the bed in full grump, little did I know that the walk would change our lives. Chapter 2. The rest of the family were already well ahead on this 100% unnecessary walk. If we'd had a decent internet connection, I'd have put up a fight. The future turns on moments like this. How do I describe the landscape? Well, I've never been good at writing, so I'm going to have to rely quite heavily on your imagination. It's big. The bigness of the place is what strikes you. The sky is really big, like an upside-down ocean. And the moors are big too. Their knobbly turf runs as far as it can, north to south, east to west, before it hits mountains. Because, yes, there are mountains near our house. Well, kind of near. Nearer than Nottingham. Up ahead, my family had stopped. This always meant trouble. Dad often called these moments learning opportunities. He probably found a dead moth or something. Mum held her arms out to offer a hug I wouldn't accept. "Come on, slow coach," she said. "Isn't it like something from Bronte up here? Are your boots chafing?" We all looked at my shoes. I had trainers on. I wasn't sure what chafing meant. It sounded like it had something to do with birds. "Oh, Kit, why aren't you wearing your boots?" "That's not fair," said Jack, yanking at Dad's arm. "He's wearing trainers. I didn't know he was wearing trainers. Why is he allowed to wear trainers?" Dad ignored his second best son. "Jack wants a race," he said. "Are you going to race your brother, Kit? Give us adults some quiet time for," he made air quotes, "serious conversation. Your mother wants a chat." "But I..." My voice trailed off. Arguing was pointless. Once Jack had an idea within his thick skull, he'd keep whining until he wore you down. Mum had probably used a similar technique to persuade Dad to move here. Jack was already off and running, shouting, "First one to the water!" over his shoulder. In the distance, after the length of about 2 football pitches, the green-brown heathland was interrupted by a stream. It ran along a trench that cut through the landscape. Because of the flat moor on either side, you couldn't see it until you were pretty much in it. We discovered it last week, just before Jack fell over while trying to catch a tiddler. "Come on, Kit," said Dad. "Exercise is good for your well-being. Get that blood pumping." Instead of explaining that not being endlessly forced to go for walks would be better for my well-being, I broke away from Mum and Dad at a jog. I ran at a steady pace, gaining on Jack. There was no point in catching him. He'd have a temper tantrum if I won. He was 10, not even 2 years younger than me, but acted like he still went to nursery. He was mad about dinosaurs, if you can believe that. Occasionally, he turned to offer a rude word that was lost to the Highland winds. April up here is like February back home. Home. Oh, that's how I thought of Nottingham. Sometimes at night when I closed my eyes, I'd imagine I was in my bed there. I'd found Jack's breathing annoying back then. We'd shared a room. I never thought I'd miss the sound. I watched Jack's head bobbing along ahead of me, and then he vanished. A click of your fingers, snap, and he was gone. He'd reached the stream. He'd won. I upped my pace, clinging to the unlikely hope that he'd tripped a few metres before the watery finish line. But no. I slid down the dip, rustling thistles nipping at my ankles, and found Jack crouched with his back to me. At his walking boots, water as clear as the stuff you'd buy in a bottle bubbled downstream. Wondering briefly why he wasn't calling me a loser, I bent over, my hands on my thighs, trying to slow my breathing. I thought I was fitter than this. He spoke, but didn't turn round. "What's that?" "You're both so fast," said Mum from the higher ground behind us. "Maybe this could be a thing. We could do it every weekend. Fen running. Is that what it's called? My two boys, fen running champions."
"You're thinking of fell running," said Dad.
"I didn't fall," said Jack. "I found something." Mum and Dad approached, taking the mild slope carefully like their middle-aged legs were made of middle-aged glass, and Jack showed us what he'd discovered. It looked like a novelty keyring, but weird enough to bother picking up. The same colour as the stones and pebbles in the stream, it was the size of a fat sausage and could nestle neatly enough in a hot dog roll. It had 2 layers, a grey exterior wrapped round something else, like a big winter coat your mum said you'd grow into. The 2 long edges of grey didn't meet in the middle. Through the gap, you could make out a thin seam of red, which made it seem vaguely dangerous. Jack held it to his ear. It was wet from the stream.
Nothing, he said, as if he'd been expecting it to tick like a bomb.
I didn't know what the object was, but you find all kinds of freaky stuff in the countryside. Have you ever heard of owl pellets? Proper disgusting.
It was probably some rubbish a hiker had left behind. Despite being in the middle of nowhere, we often found Coke cans bleached by the sun and crisp packets trembling in the wind. Mum and Dad had already lost interest. They were talking dinner. "I mean," said Dad, "we don't have to have Scottish food every day. Root vegetables are international, Brian." "So," Dad said, "shall we walk up to the toilet stone, or..." Although you could see the cliffs from here, they and their monolith, a huge chunk of mineral that looked, according to Dad, like a portaloo, were still a good 30 minutes walk away, which meant that when Jack interrupted Dad to say, "Go home," I didn't argue. I didn't give the device a second thought. But the next morning, I was woken up by five words you never want to hear. Not, "The internet is down again," but, "There's a police officer downstairs." Chapter 3. It was not a great sentence and definitely not one you want to wake up to. Getting out of bed is bad enough without mention of the police. And it was Sunday, the best morning for a lie-in. Mum continued, "She wants to know something about a tracker." I said I didn't have a scooby what she was on about, so get some clothes on, Kit, and come downstairs. Honestly, I don't know. It's like something from an Ian Rankin novel. You might have thought Mum should have been more alarmed, but one, she never really gets alarmed, and two, Dad's a special constable. This meant that, long ago, with the rest of us, she'd learnt to associate the police with boredom and, in particular, really dull stories about the correct way of disposing of chewing gum or whatever. Dad was well into it, though. The actual police officer was sitting at our kitchen table, coffee steamed. Next to her mug, Mum's, it said world's best writer on it, and it felt weird that someone else was drinking from it, was a police hat. Attached to her stab vest was a police radio. She had all the gear, and specifically gear unavailable to Dad because of funding cuts, we'd been told. Anyway, it wasn't all this that had me feeling both incredibly cold and also breaking out the armpit sweat, my heart knocking a breakbeat against my ribcage. No, it was the word Mum had used shortly after waking me. Tracker. Confession. Sometimes I borrow films off the internet. But surely I couldn't get arrested for that. They send you a letter first. Back in Nottingham, it happened to a friend's brother. But this was Scotland. They do things differently here. The police officer nodded to me, as did Dad, who sat at the table with her. I was surprised he hadn't dug out his uniform instead of wearing the cringe purple dressing gown. Mum leant her backside against one of the worktops. "This is our son, Kit," Dad said. "Kit, this is PC Lennox. Maybe you can assist in her investigation." Lennox didn't say good morning, didn't smile, didn't acknowledge my introduction. Instead, she continued talking. "I assumed the signal appearing again was a glitch, but when I logged on, the computer sent me here." She placed a finger on the kitchen table, but I think she meant the house rather than the kitchen, because even police GPS can't be that accurate. "The beauty of your place being so isolated meant I knew right away where I was being led to. I'd found the location." "But the problem is," said Mum, smiling wildly, "that we have absolutely no idea what you're talking about." "I didn't think I was breaking the law," I said in a tiny voice. The three adults turned their attention to me.
"Kit," said Dad, "honesty is the best policy when you're dealing with the authorities. It'll come out in the end. They have ways of making you talk."
Mum spoke strangely, pushing the words between her lips, her jaw unmoving.
"Is there something you want to tell us? Something that maybe you should have said before an actual real police officer was sitting at our table?
No offence, Brian."
"None taken," said Dad.
I took a deep breath.
"Well, are you looking for this?"
asked Jack. I'd never been so pleased to see my brother. He stood there, framed by the kitchen door, wearing his Man City top, a team he supports, not because he even likes football, but because they win everything. and he was holding the thing he'd found in the stream.
It looks slightly different now. I could see.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.